الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم فأما من طغى وآثر الحياة الدنيا فإن الجحيم هي المأوى وأما من خاف مقام ربه ونهى النفس عن الهوى فإن الجنة هي المأوى وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ثلاث منجيات وثلاث مهلكات وثلاث درجات وثلاث كفارات فأما المنجيات فخشية الله في السر والعلانية والقصد في الفقر والغنى والغضب في الرضا والغضب وأما المهلكات فشح شديد وهوى متبع وإعجاب المرء بنفسه وأما الدرجات فإفشاء السلام وإطعام الطعام والصلاة بالليل والناس نيام وأما الكفارات فإصباغ الوضوء في الصبرات ونقل الأقدام إلى الجماعات وانتظار الصلاة بعد الصلاة صدق الله وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, last Friday we were talking about this hadith of Abu Huraira رضي الله تعالى عنه, where Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم has mentioned the 12 things or 12 practices. He said, three practices or actions are there which can give you a success or victory here and also in the hereafter. three other practices or deeds, it can perish a person concerned. And three other actions, it can give you excellent grades. And three more, it can erase your sins from your personal file. The first category, فَخَشْيَةُ اللَّهِ فِي السِّرِّ وَالْعَلَانِيَةِ. The fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you are there in a gathering, or when you are alone and alone. And as you know, fasting in the month of Ramadan, in Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned two hikmas. كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. The philosophy in fasting is so you may have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As I mentioned before, that fasting, that is a self-assessment, self-accountability, and self-control system. We do not eat or drink at daytime. Even though if we are not watched by anybody, but because of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is self-assessment, that is self-control system. Once Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asked the Sahaba, أَتَدْرُونَ مَنِ الشَّدِيدِ. You know a strong and powerful man? Sahaba said, yes, that one who can defeat his opponent in wrestling. He is a strong man. He is a powerful man. He is considered a champion, having a belt. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَسْتُ ذَاكَ أُرِيدُ. I'm not talking about such like powerful and strong man. بَلِ الشَّدِيدُ هُوَ الَّذِي يَقْمِدُ نَفْسَهُ عِنْدَ الْغَضَبُ. A strong man is that one. When he becomes angry, he can control himself. And he does not go ahead. Again, that is a self-control system. So fasting in the month of Ramadan is self-control. خَشْيَةُ اللَّهِ فِي السِّرِّ وَالْعَلَانِيَةِ. The fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you are seen by people, or you are not, once Jibreel came in shape of a strange man to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, asked him a few questions. What is Iman? What is Islam? And the third question he asked the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أخبرني عن الإحسان. Inform me about Ihsan. Ihsan is husn. Husn means beauty. And beauty of two types. Number one, beauty in your physical structure, in your dress, or beauty in your character and your deeds and actions. Then again, Another classification of ihsan is to be kind to your fellow human being. And number two, to be kind to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah said, children of Israel, they said to Qarun or Korah, وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. Be kind to Allah as He is to you. In a hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said so. What's wrong with people? I do provide them, they violate my rules. I show my kindness to them, they transgress the boundaries. I'm very kind to them, they challenge my authority. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. Be kind to Allah as He is to you. So it means, we as Muslims, we are bound to be kind to Allah. What it means? When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked by Jibreel, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَنْتَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ فَإِنْ لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ. To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with such a strong belief, concentration and due attention, as you are looking at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ihfazillah tajidhu tujahak. Be mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For sure you will find Him standing in front of you. So antabudallaha ka'annaka tarahu. We are standing in our prayer, Ya Subhanallah. What type of mindfulness we have in our prayer? We recite Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen and driving on 118. We recite Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen and roaming around somewhere in store. Due concentration in your ibadah, that is needed. أَنْتَابُدَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ فَإِنْ لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ. If you cannot make your concentration to that level, at least you may make your belief that much strong that Allah is watching. He is looking at me. He looks how I pray. He looks how I fast. He looks how I practice. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, that is called khashyatullah fi sirri wal alaniya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, wa amma man khafa maqama rabbihi wa nahan nafsa 'anil hawa fa innal jannata hiya al ma'wa. Whosoever fears of standing in front of Allah for accountability on the day of judgment, what will be the result? If somebody will have that type of belief, وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ مَنِ الْهَوَىٰ, he will control himself, he will control his evil desires. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the ultimate result is, فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَىٰ, paradise will be his abode. That will be his place for eternal living. But the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, sometimes we do not violate the rule of Allah. Why? People are there. If nobody is there, we will jump over. It means you were not doing yesterday what you were not doing because of the fear of public. not because of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, what is wrong with you today that you jumped at the same ram when people are not there? فَخَشْيَةُ اللَّهِ فِي السِّرِّ وَالْعَلَانِيَةِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَيْبِ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَأَجْرٌ كَبِيرٌ وَأَجْرٌ كَرِيمٌ Such like people will be having a generous reward from Allah. Forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number two, وَالْقُصْدُ فِي الْفُقْرِ وَالْغِنَانَ Be medium. Balance. Doesn't matter if you are a rich man or you are a poor. You have a little or a lot, but your life must be a balanced one. Your way of life must be a balanced one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, balance, tawazun, and i'tidal. That is natural system and natural requirement as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالسَّمَاءَ رَفَعَهَا وَوَضَعَ الْمِيزَانَ اللَّهَ تَطْغَوْ فِي الْمِيزَانِ Allah says, think about natural system, which Allah has established. Now specifically look at the space, how balanced Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has established it. If the sun would have been a little bit down or lower than its place, the whole world would have been burnt. If it would have been a little bit up, the whole world would have been frozen. So Allah says, it means, keep up with the balance. Do not tamper the nature. Do not disturb the natural system. And keep up with balance in your life and way of life everywhere. وَأَقِيمُ الْوَزْنَ بِالْقِسْطِ وَلَا تُخْسِرُ الْمِيزَانِ The message of this ayah is, never disturb the balance in no way. In Surah Al-Hadid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلَنَا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأَنْزَلْنَا مَعَهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْمِيزَانِ لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we sent our messenger with the clear rules, one mizan, and with a balanced system. Every messenger was given a balanced system in his time. Same is the case of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For the whole world, until the day of judgment, Allah has given him such a system, which is the ultimate balance system for him. So Allah says, وَأَنْزَلْنَا مَعَهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْمِيزَانَ لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ So human being may keep up with justice, with balance, with tawazun, with i'tidal, not to be extremist on this side or on that side. And Allah says in Holy Quran, specifically about the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا خِيَارًا عَدُولًا I said to my friend, in tafsir class, write down this word, وَسَطًا خِيَارًا عَدُولًا Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says for the same purpose, I have made you the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best of the human being, number one, and the just and balanced people. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has fixed our duty, a balanced life, but we are totally imbalanced. And how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taking care of this balance? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, look, a sahabi was sitting in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This button of him was open. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, if you don't need it, why you have put it here? If that is needed, why you have not closed it? Balance. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إذا انقطع شراك النعل أحدكم فلا يمشين في نعل واحد. فهم صلى الله عليه وسلم من ونا في your shoe is broken, you are walking. So Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, don't walk in one shoe. Physically, medically that is not good for your bones. Especially both big bones, especially in America. Everybody has the problem. Yes. And Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, if you are walking like this, yes, everybody will be noticing, what's wrong with this guy? So Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, just take away the other one as well to keep your walking a balanced mind. Sayyidina Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, I saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam 10 years, 24/7, day and night. I have never seen any imbalance in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If I, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, used to tie his hair, he had long hair. And when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to wake up, Sayyidina Anas Sa'id radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the first ever thing he was doing, yes, to discipline his hair. Yes, to discipline his hair. Not looking good. Imbalanced life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. The same concept has been made clear here in this hadith by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَالْقَصْدُ فِي الْفَقْرِ وَالْغِنَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تُبَذِّرْ تَبْذِيرًا. In the mubadhirin, say, كانوا إخوان الشياطين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, never be a spendthrift. Yes, we will never be. Yes, that's our case. Yes, we know dollar works. Dollar means something. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, on the other hand, never be miser and bakhil and stingy as well. وَلَا تَجْعَلْ يَدَكَ مَغْلُولَةً إِلَىٰ هُنُكِكَ وَلَا تَبْسُطْهَا كُلَّ الْبَسْطِ فَتَقْعُدَ مَلُومًا مَحْصُورًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, never be stingy, never be miser. Whatever you have, I was telling my brothers in Tafsir class, that Abu Hanifa rahimahullah used to give financial aid to 4,000 ulama and students of Quran and Sunnah from his own pockets. And he was giving them that much, that everybody should have along with his family a delicious food, a beautiful dress, a beautiful shoes, arrive at that time, every need and necessity. And once in his class, yes, he noticed that there is a student, but his clothes were dirty. When the dust was done, yes, today I will try to do that. Do you think so? I don't have, otherwise I would have done it. Anyhow, Abu Hanifa noticed it. When the dust was done and students were going out, Imam Rahmahullah, he followed that student. When he was lone and alone, he got hold of him. And he said, take it. Have a few dresses. Beautiful. And when you are coming to Quran and Hadith, so you must have beautiful dress. Respected brothers and sisters, the student said, Ya Imam, ma'ziratan, li min az-zuru'i wad-duru'i kaza wa kaza. I'm a very big businessman. I have my own range. I have my farms. That much agriculture product. That much money and deposits I have. So Imam Zahra smiled at him. And he told him, Iza ahsan Allahu ilayka fahalla yura alayka atharuha. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that much kind to you, so why its effect are not seen on your body then? وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whatever favor Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon you, the effect should be seen there clearly. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, the same thing happened to a Sahabi when he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as you know, the Prophet by nature, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was very nafis man. He was very clean and neat man. Sayyidina Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, I have never seen any dirt or dust on the columns of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken care of. So he saw a sahabi. He asked him, if you cannot afford, I will give you something. He said, I have a lot. رب صلى الله عليه وسلم referred to the ayah سورة الضحى وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. So why you are not paying thanks to the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah says, وَلَا تَجْعَلْ يَدَكَ مَغْلُولَةً إِلَىٰ غُنُقِ. Never tie your hands to your neck. That was a muhawara or a proverb mostly used by the people of Arabia at that time regarding a miser and niggardly person, that he has tied his hands to his neck. Means he is not taking his hand to his pocket to bring out something and to spend it. So they used to say, as we in other area, we say that in his pocket he had a scorpion. Yes, if he will put his hand inside, he's stung. So that's why he's not doing that, or not committing that mistake. He will never do that. So Allah says, وَلَا تَجْعَلْ يَدَكَ مَغْلُولَةً إِلَىٰ هُنُكِ. Never tie your hands to your neck. Yes, untie it, put it in this pocket, and give to this one. In the other pocket, and give to this one. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says still, you have to keep your hand balanced. وَلَا تَبْسُطْهَا كُلَّ الْبَسْطِ. Do not stretch forth your hand that much open to this one, to this one, to this one, to this one. And never calculate that how much I give. Do I have something for myself or not? Because we are not a people of great nature. That if we will get hungry and we will say, okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may accept my sadaqah. I do not have anything for myself. But thank God I have given it for the sake of Allah. Oh Allah, you promised I will give 10 for 1, but I am dying of hunger. Where is the 10 for? You will lose your iman making such a complaint to Allah. Who told you that spend everything you have? That was only the case of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Aisha says radiallahu ta'ala anha, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he received from Oman and Bahrain. Here from? From Oman and Bahrain. 90,000 dinar at that time. Yes, subhanAllah. A big hill of dinars were there in front of Rasulullah in Masjid. And Sahaba were coming. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was giving them. Everybody was holding his cloth. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was putting like this. Like this. After Asr, before Maghrib, the job was accomplished. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam led them in prayer. And then he came home. He asked the Sayyida Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, هَلْ فِي الدَّارِ شَيْءٌ لِيُوكَلْ. Aisha, do you have anything for eating? Sayyida Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha says, O the Messenger of Allah, I was waiting for 1 or 2 dinar, that you will bring something, we will buy and cook it. You didn't? So I don't have anything, only water and dates are there. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, give me 3 dates and 1 cup of water. He ate 3 days, 1 cup of water. After that he distributed 90,000 dinars. And then he said, Alhamdulillah, Alladhi at'amani wa saqani wa ja'alani min al-muslimin. Praise be to that Allah who fed me, who provided me with this water, and he has given me Islam and Iman. But take was the case of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Allah says, وَلَا تَجْعَلْ يَدَكَ مَغْلُولَةً إِلَىٰ هُنُكِ وَلَا تَبْسُطْهَا كُلَّ الْبَسْطِ فَتَقْعُدَ مَلُومًا مَحْصُورًا. Never tie your hands to your neck to be niggardly. Miser is stingy, but don't stretch forth your hand that much open that you have spent everything giving to this one, to that one. You don't have nothing, neither for yourself nor for your family. So what will be the ultimate result? فَتَقْعُدَ مَلُومًا. If a person is niggardly, فَتَقْعُدَ مَلُومًا, he would be blamed by community. And you know, that somebody who is known for his stinginess or miserliness, that he is a niggardly person. People say, leave him alone. He is not a man. Allah has given him that much. Ya subhanAllah, he is not giving a single dollar to a poor man. He never gave, I have never seen him that he has given $1,000 to masjid, or to institution, or to a poor. Leave him alone. He is not a man. So Allah said, فَتَقْوْدَ مَلُومًا. If Allah has given you and you do not do that, so you would be blamed by the community. And number two, if you spent everything and you have nothing, mahsooran, people will be feeling sorry for you. He was a stupid man, a crazy man. Allah had given him a lot. He was spending like this. Now he doesn't have anything to eat. صلى الله سبحانه وتعالى says keep up the balance. وكذلك جعلناك أمة وسطا. فرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said والقصد في الفقر والغنى. قصد me balance. يعني حديث رابط صلى الله عليه وسلم says الاقتصاد نصف المعيشة وما عاد من اقتصد. فال Islamic economics, this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is enough base. Al-iqtisadu nisful ma'isha wa ma ghala man iqtasada. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, al-iqtisadu nisful ma'isha. What is little meaning of iqtisad? Iqtisad means to keep up with balance. Neither to this degree, nor to that degree. And iqtisad is a term. Iqtisad is a term, economics, that is defined how to earn and how to spend. How to earn and how to spend. To keep up with balance in your earning and spending both. That's called iqtisad. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, someone who will keep up with balance in his earning and spending, it means that he has controlled 50% of his life. وَمَا عَلَى مَنْ اِقْتَصَدَى. And a person who will practice the same, he will never become a beggar. He will never become a poor. But what we do? Ya subhanallah. A kesar beer to the north of Primardi. Number one. Loan from banks. Car, Mercedes of 2020. Yes, 15 years before. A new model. Because that's a matter of prestige. So the ultimate result is, number one, you are involved in haram, riba, and interest. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidina Anas said, لعن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم آكل الربا وموكله وشاهديه وكاتبه ويروى من سعر فيه رواه مسلم وكما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم said Allah has cursed one who is giving interest, one who is receiving interest, one who is writing the document of interest, someone who is becoming a witness and testifying the document of witness, وَلِمَنْ سَغَاتِهِ. And one who is running in between them to do their job. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that one of the symbols and signs of Qiyamah is that people will be involved, majority of them would be involved in riba and usury business. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, فَإِلَّمْ يَاكُلْهُ يَسِلُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ غُبَارِهِ. Ya subhanallah, what a prophet. فَإِلَّمْ يَاكُلْهُ يَسِلُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ غُبَارِهِ. If he is not directly involved therein, he will be having a smoke of usury and riba and interest there in his life. Ya subhanallah, the imam is involved, the sheikh is involved, the mufti is involved, the qadi is involved, and the bad thing is that we are doing haram and we do not think that this is haram. Our iman is on stake. Our iman is in a big danger. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, if somebody commits a mistake, and he still admits that that is a mistake, Allah will forgive him. But if somebody says, no, this is nothing wrong with this. If every one of us, ya subhanallah, we have become mufti for free. Yes, like someone become doctor for free. Yes, engineer for free. Yes, where you have studied deen? Yes, subhanallah, Allah has given me ilmi laduni, gifted knowledge. Yes. So I say, yes, that gifted knowledge will be make you a gift to hellfire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us. Respected brothers and sisters in Islam, so anyhow, alhamdulillah, we had the month of Ramadan. We did fasting, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it. Yes, we prayed our tarawih and qiyamul layl, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it. We helped each other in one way or the other, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it. But we did it as a refresher course. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it in such a way that we must do the same practice in whole year. It doesn't mean that tomorrow after Eid prayer, we will be hugging. Eid Mubarak. Yes. What? Eid Mubarak. See you inshallah next year in Ramadan. Yeah. For this 11 months, that's enough. We have done a lot. We don't eat that much. I was telling his brother, one of my friends back home in Pakistan, he is making a lot of jokes. So when I go back after Hajj to Pakistan, so he comes, once he asks me, that how many Hajj you have done? And how many Umrah? I said, I don't count. So he said, now you should stop it. I said, why? So he said, that look, there are certain stops that if you will get to the bus, $5, so they will drop you on such and such stop.
If you will pay that much, they will drop you to Peshawar. If you will pay to the bus driver or to the conductor that much, they will take you to Lahore. If you will pay to the train that much, they will take you to Karachi. But if you will pay more, so they will drop you there in the ocean. Because you have extra. So he said, you will be having extra ticket. And if the angels will take you based upon the tickets you have paid, so they will take you beyond Jannah. There are deserts, nothing is there. So respected brothers and sisters in Islam, don't think like that. That if I will do much more, that will be further more extra. And I will be beyond Jannah. No, still we have to do a lot. Still we have, because there's a long way to go. So this is a refresher course. My humble request is, please, for the sake of Allah, keep yourself committed to deen of Allah as you were in the month of Ramadan. As you were in the month of Ramadan, if you will keep up with the same practice, you will see the after effects. You will see the results in your life, in your family, in Muslim Ummah as a whole. So my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, inshallah, today we are going to complete our 30s. Yes, yesterday, I took my students, even though I was well aware of that there is no any possibility of moon sighting, as their son was said. Yes, but anyhow, that was our 29, and that is Fardu Kifaya. To go there, which is called in Sipa, Lailatul Iqtimar. So we went there, we broke our fasting there on the mountain. Yes, we tried, but we couldn't. But today we are not bound to try to sight the moon. Alhamdulillah, we have completed our 30 days. If somebody will go and he will see it, even though still, the son of us said that today, once again, the crescent will be that much lower that without binocular, nobody will be able to see it. Because that will be in the level of only 4 degrees from the earth. So that will be very difficult to see it with the naked eyes. To see it with the neck. Actually, the brothers and sisters, they do ask us, oh, such and such country, they have already celebrated it. Why you are not celebrating? You know what I'm saying? So, I pose the question like this, that for such a country they did not celebrate the Eid, why these people celebrated it? And that is the case of such a country. So, majority of them, they have not celebrated. You know what I'm saying? In the Middle East, if you will collect together all Muslims here, how much they will be in number? I don't think so that they will complete only our population in Pakistan. Because we are very fertile people. Yes. So, we are 170 million in Pakistan, 170 million in Bangladesh, and almost 200 million in India. Yes, so if you will gather together there, many Muslims, so it means that majority have not celebrated the Eid. So if you are making an objection to us, we have to make that objection to you. Let's have democracy. Respected brothers and sisters in Islam, so that's not a case of democracy, that's a case of Sharia. But the best thing is, Iran bid'ah has started the Ummah. For the last 1400 years, nobody has ever practiced this type of bid'ah. And that bid'ah is moon birth. What? Moon birth. Moon birth, that is the case of Falakiyat and astronomy. Sharia has nothing to do with. Sharia has to do with crescent, moon sighting. The base of Sharia is moon sighting. That is not moon birth. As far as the case of Sadaqatul Fitr is concerned, so once again, there will be $7 per person, those who can afford, according to Abu Hanifa. You have to follow Abu Hanifa, you will be feeling easy. Yes. Yes, I am making a joke. Because three imams said that all those who have fasted in the month of Ramadan, they are bound to pay Sadaqatul Fitr. For them and their family. Oh brother, if they are poor. They said, Rasulullah said, those who fasted. So Rasulullah said certain other things. That who did, those who did so, they must pay charity. Can we ask the poor man that you should pay charity? So Abu Hanifa said, La sadaqata illa an zahri dinan. Prophet has given us a general rule that there is no charity but for one who can afford it. So that's why that hadith is explained in the light of the second hadith. So those who can afford, they will pay $7 per person from his side and from his family.